You listen to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. We are back on the road. We're on the road to Aberdeen Anarchy. I am on the road to Aberdeen Anarchy because I'm on the road to Aberdeen to go watch Aberdeen Anarchy. So this is 2 o'clock for your time check, if you so wish to have it. I'm paranoidly checking to make sure it's recording this time. Because I think the last time we did a proper road trip, it did not, so I had to do it again. And I ran out of space, and it's one of those things. That's the joys of this particular style of podcast. The temperature is nuts. I don't have it right in front, 28 degrees in the car. Actually, I do have it in front of me, 28 degrees, and we're going to go and see some wrestling today. Yes, WrestleZone Aberdeen Anarchy, May 11th, 2024. I'm super hyped. We're going to speak about the card in a second. I suppose I better do some kind of housekeeping a little bit, because the last time we did the road trip, it was for Discovery Wrestling, so it was a little bit different because it was me and Kelly doing it. This was a really fun episode to record and do, because we were doing it. We had the camera set up at the hotel and did all that kind of stuff. So this is a little bit different, because back to the normal, where I had to wedge my phone somewhere so you could possibly hear me and possibly see me as well, because otherwise it makes the video medium of this kind of podcast absolutely useless. But I'm absolutely hyped for this. I've been very lucky. The guys at WrestleZone have been very kind to me to allow me access to their training academy to record a little sit down with Caleb Valhalla, which was fantastic, because it was one of those ones where we had all these kind of plans for what we were going to do, and then one by one everything became snake bit, and we just kind of had to set up this tripod that I've got this phone on now. I had to set it up on a pile of stuff. We found some of the banners, we made a background, we made a whole kind of wee studio thing. Only thing I'm annoyed about when you watch it back is I didn't move one of the TV stands, so there's like a little bit of metal in the way of one of the banners, and it irritates me to look at, because I thought I did a really, really good job of making it look as like in studio as possible. Besides that, I had a really great time. It was one of the, we said to get edited. And it turned out fantastic, because it was 10 minutes we recorded. There's some bloopers here and there, and it was condensed down into 8-9 minutes in total, with clips through it. And it was a fantastic job. It was better than anything I could have done when it came to it. So, but I'm glad that I was asked to do it, and I'm glad that I did it as well, because it's one of those weeks, right? So it's going to come out in weeks and weeks time, but it was one of those weeks where we did Discovery the week before, and then the week after that I was at McMurray, so that's 2 days of pretty much a solid drinking and listening to pop acts and whatnot, which I loved. Singing, screaming loud, watching Blue, Apple, I'm cool with that. So we did that. So that was Saturday and Sunday. Monday we did the recording with Caleb in Aberdeen, so I had to get the train into Aberdeen, walk over to the training academy, which is a lot further than I thought, but I think that's mainly because I did the Trinity Centre steps and I wanted to die after that. So did that. Tuesday, Monday evening, I was offered a chat with Ace Austin, thanks to the guys at TNA. So I was like, how am I going to make this a Scottish spin? So I thought, okay, I'll ask about Joe Henry and the chart success, etc. So at least I can tick that box. So I went, yeah, okay, cool, I'll do that. But I'd already organised a chat that evening with Kat Wolf, SW ring announcer. SW interviewer and part-time ring announcer for, I think, it's a Blockbuster and Outgirders, possibly. It says not Blockbuster, it was Outgirders. But anyway, so that was at 8, and the chat with Ace Austin was 20 past 7. It got delayed, so I pretty much went, chat with Ace Austin, wrapped that up, waited for the video process, it processed, onto the chat with Kat, which was amazing. You know, it was one of those ones where I didn't have any notes. I didn't know really what to speak about with Kat. And then she was so given in the chat that we just went on to tangents and everything about mermaids and all that kind of stuff. It was just fantastic. She was a great guest. If she wants to do any more podcasts, I would highly recommend Kat Wolf to be on the podcast. So we did that. And then Wednesday, we had the par. So I spoke to Ross Hunter and Robert Balfour, and that was a different kind of chat, but a lot of fun again. So that wasn't quite an hour, but it was in the time that we had together, we got a lot of things in there, a lot of things about the par and upcoming matches at Power Pro and Rise of Power on June 13th. So it was a really constructive chat, you know. So that was Wednesday. Thursday, then I was able to catch up on the Eurovision semis, and then Friday I was able to actually breathe and relax for once this week. So it has been a hell of a week, and I'm very excited about this show. I kind of have a little bit of a gap between doing things because I don't think I've got anything like properly on now for a couple of weeks. I've got some recordings in the evenings and all that kind of stuff. This has been 3 very intense weekends. Of stuff between wrestling and everything else. So yeah, Aberdeen Anarchy kind of full stops that 3 weeks of madness. So elsewhere, road trips currently planned. I've booked the time off. I haven't got my ticket for Community Pro in Peterhead. That is on July 12th. I've got W3L again. Haven't got my ticket for it yet, but that's the end. I think it's 27th of July, and then Battle of the Nations is August 10th, I think. So I think that's my next 3 events. We'll do a All About the Disco thing about Walk with Discovery Wrestling. That's July 14th, I think it is. That doesn't seem right. Yeah, July 14th, yeah, because Community Pro is Friday. So with that. So there's a little bit of a gap between doing a lot of things, really, between the WrestleZone podcast and the Discovery podcast. I'm sorry, I'm not sure I know so much, it's because heat and moustache hair and all that kind of fun stuff. So there's going to be a big gap between, like, the Auxiliary podcasts and the like. We'll have some fair city ones in the meantime by Patrick Patrick Petersky and I'm so sorry, I've forgotten. I can see it in my mind's eye. It'll come back to me. Patrick Petersky, Kieran Douglas, that's it. That was a very, very confusing minute. But yeah, Kieran Douglas, not safe for mums. They've been doing some cracking work recently on the FCW podcast, so look forward to having more of that as well. So there's a lot happening in this. And this week I've really felt like I'm a good podcaster. You know, I've done this podcast for 4 years, and this is the one time that I actually sat back and went, you know what? I'm not bad at this. I'm not bad at being a podcaster. Which is a very weird thing to say out loud and just to think, because I'm just a very pessimistic person about my own accomplishments. But considering this week, I had a chat with a TNA superstar, I did a sit down interview that was used on a wrestling promotion's social media, I did a big hype video chat with Scottie Swift that went out before Aberdeen Anarchy as well. That was the Friday. I feel like I'm nailing this for once, you know? It's not a feeling that happens often, but I'm feeling it right now. I kind of like these road trips episodes when I'm on my own in the car a little bit. I love going shows with Kelly, but doing this bit, I just have a little bit of therapy for like 20 minutes. I just kind of ramble away and talk and just have just a little bit of me time. Oh, that's my breaks. Fantastic. Right, so WrestleZone, Aberdeen Anarchy. Let's do this. Let's talk about Aberdeen Anarchy. So this will be, I've went to every Aberdeen Anarchy since 2013. This will be my 10th one? No, 9th? 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 22, 23, 24, 10. And my breaks never do this, and neither doing it when I'm doing this podcast. So that's 10th, that's my 10th Aberdeen Anarchy, my god. So 10 Aberdeen Anarchies, I have seen dizzying heights, even higher heights, because I've always enjoyed Aberdeen Anarchy. It's been one of my favourite events of the year. Probably second favourite event of the year. First one being the Regal Rumble. Regal Rumble's always number one in my books, but Aberdeen Anarchy is always like nipping at his heels, second place. So I had my ticket for it. Kelly was just like, I've done this go, I didn't back money, I need a weekend. just the quietness. So it's me, it's going by myself to see it. I am shorts up. I have picked my lightest t-shirt that I have in my collection, which is the Aspen Lost by Aspen Grand Slam shirt. Conveniently enough, even though head and heart, I think Caleb's winning tonight. But I'm gonna believe till the very end. My heart's gonna go no. It's gonna be Aspen. So we've got. This is why I've kind of picked this shirt. It's kind of dual use. It's both lighter shirt and the most it's supporting Aspen. And I've also got this bad boy, which I don't think I'll wear at the show, but I've got it with me because there'll probably be a little bit of wandering between the show and between me getting there and the show itself, which I haven't done this drive to Rich Energy Arena in light, because the only other time I've been there, it was January, the weather was rotten and cold and snowy. I was feeling pretty rotten, cold and snowy. It wasn't a fun journey through because of that. Just because it's January, it's always a roll of the dice what you're gonna get weather wise. So I haven't done this journey in the light, so looking forward to actually maybe seeing stuff that's about, because I found a KFC, I found an Aldi. Really, that's all I needed. That's all I needed at that time to kill time before the show. As far as weather, like say it was 28 degrees, now 26, it's getting colder. So I've only taken a short, a sleeveless hoodie with me, which every other time I've taken a sleeveless hoodie to a show, I have had a cold the following week. So I'm hoping that's not the case this time, because I've got a chat with Reece Dawkins on Monday. I really don't want to be ill doing that. So yeah, I'm excited. This is the 10th one. 10 Aberdeen Anarchies I've been to. My goodness. So in that time, I've met plenty of amazing guests that they've reported over. Starting with Hacksaw Jim Duggan and Billy Gunn, with X-Pac and Scotty Too Haughty. I'm going to throw about the years a little bit. Devon Dudley, Chris Masters, Hardcore Holly, Carlito, Hurricane, Hornswoggle, Rikishi, Molina, Pac. Who am I missing? I feel like I'm missing something. Oh, Bill James, Mickey Mago's favourite wrestler, you know. Is everyone I can think of off the top of my head? Oh, I've probably forgotten somebody. So I've seen some fantastic matches during that time. And matches that have stuck with me forever. I mean, my first ever opener for Aberdeen Anarchy was Steve Boy Xavier against Bingo Balance. That was phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal. So there have been great matches over the years. Wesley Crane versus Scotty Hoy, Jack Jester, Christian Crabe. That was 2015. It's a match that I've mentioned so many times that Grado knows that's my favourite Aberdeen Anarchy show. That time it was on Wrestling Daft, but that was still a thing. Even Grado knows that's my favourite match. So yeah, that's means I've said it too much possibly. So yeah, I've seen some fantastic Pac versus Zack Dynamite. Some great ladder matches. Ladder matches have always been phenomenal. We've got our ladder match tonight. I've been lucky. Aberdeen Anarchy has always been a very good event for me, to be a fan and to watch and to just enjoy wrestling. And tonight looks like it's no different. We're going to see six matches, one failed the VIP pre-show, as always. And I would try and fit this all in before I stop at my folks to drop off the dog. The dog's in the boot, just panting away. That flapping you can hear is because I've got a window open in the back, because it is roasting. So yeah, I'm going to try and rattle through it a little bit. I might end up doing a little bit more recording as the day progresses. I might not. The thing you see may just be the in-ring bit and then into the montage. But we'll start with the pre-show, which is Chris Archer taking on Evan Young. And if Chris Archer wins, then Evan Young and Oliver Green must join Chris Archer as their understudies. And it's a rematch from Granite City Showdown from back in January at the Rich Energy Arena. At that point, Evan Young picked up the win. And you know what? I've done a kind of proper preview of it. I've kind of half chatted with it with Scotty because the match hadn't been announced at that point. Taking away the professional bit of it where I'm doing the preview and why this match is happening, I want to see Archer win. I want to see Archer win, and I think if we see that, I think that adds a little bit more to Evan Young and Oliver Green. Evan Young, I think, would be a fantastic bad guy. I have no kind of follow up to that. Maybe I do. I think he's very good at showing off that he's young, you know. I know his name's Evan Young, Mr. 2004 himself. I think that's something that he can really tap into, because he did a preview. My brakes aren't normally this bad. It's really annoying. He did a little like thing a good while ago, where he was like did a promo-ish video where he was investigating like old things like Rory phones and stuff like that, and it was so irritating but so genius at the same time, and I really think we can see more of that. The only kind of flip side to it, the WrestleZone started to get really bad guy heavy, so I don't know if that kind of works, especially if what I think may happen, the tag match happens, the tag title match happens, it kind of starts making things a little bit lopsided. But I would like to see Evan Young and Ollie Green under the tutelage of Chris Archer. I think it would be a lot of fun, personally. If it doesn't happen, it doesn't happen. But if we get to see Young and Green as a team going forward, whether it's with Chris Archer or without him, I think that'll be good stuff. Anyway, so that's the VIP match. We'll start on to the main card now, as I noticed that I'm not that far away from Bucky. So I might need to do a part two as I go from Bucky to Aberdeen, which should be fine. We're all here together, hopefully. So big card. We'll start with the Mickey Vegas match because I always forget it on shows, and I think he's starting to think I'm doing it personally, and I'm really not. It is the big one though. It's Gangrel. Gangrel is in the match. It's Gangrel, Tommy Raiden, Mickey Vago, fanging and headbanging, taking on Judas Gray, Rhys Dawkins, and Brian Tucker. Now, I've already done the preview of it on there, so go check out the rest of the podcast if you want to go back and tell you how all this came about. But as far as my thoughts on this, I did right about the start of the year, after Granite City Showdown, and well, after Gangrel was announced-ish, I did a draft of matches I thought would happen at Aberdeen Anarchy, and I don't know if I may still have it somewhere, but I did a draft on the site. And as soon as Gangrel was announced, my first thoughts were it was going to be Vago, Raiden, and Gangrel, against Dawkins, Tucker, and I put Luke King Sharp in there because that's who he was facing, Vega was facing at Grand City Showdown. But then Judas Gray returned, and I'm very happy with that. Even though Judas throws things at me, he's just really good, and I like see. I think he's a very good wrestler, and I enjoy watching him wrestle, despite like concussions while watching it. But yeah, so to see Judas back and to see him with against Gabriel is going to be a good riot anyway, you know, because he's the kind of spooky goth dude against the vampire warrior. I want to see what Dawkins and Tucker do with them as well. I'm sure they've got garlic and they've got steaks and they've got crosses and all that kind of stuff. I think it's just going to be just such a fun match, you know. It's going to be one of those ones where you watch it and go, oh, come on, how Gangrel's agreed to this, you know, and it's going to be an absolute blast to watch. That's it. It's going to be fun. Vigo gets his import. Tommy Rita gets a big match. Speed Bell go back as a team. Well, what we see going forward from the Wallys afterwards. But yeah, I think this is going to be a lot of fun. I'm going to see Gangrel. So at the moment, right as I'm recording this, Gangrel's doing a meet and greet. I am not going to that. I'm going to the one. I'll hopefully try and get him before the show itself, or the interval, or what have you, because. Yeah, it's a long day otherwise, so I just want to leave right to you and get to the show. So yeah, I can't wait for that one. That's the kind of one of the marquee matches of this event, is Gangrel being on the show and getting to see him. I mean, you know what? Gangrel's probably going to do like, come out, do these spit of viscous fluid, maybe tag in, a little flurry, a DDT, an impaler, I should say, an impaler, and then maybe spits and misses someone, and that's it, and it's going to be amazing. So it's going to be a great time that I'm going to have at that. So hopefully I get a picture with Gangrel. I tried my best to get a hold of Gangrel before this event for an interview. It didn't happen, but you know, it's one of those things. It's just life. But can't take these things personally, because if I do, I will cry a lot. So that's the six-man tag done, VIP match done. Let's go to the ladder match then. I talked about ladder matches a moment ago. We've got TV's Omar Mohammed, who has some mighty fine merch available at the show, I've heard, and we'll see, against Captain Alan Sterling, who will also not have merch, but tell everyone not to buy a captain's hat at the show. And above them will hang Omar Mohammed's, or TV's Omar Mohammed's Shivani, and Captain Alan Sterling's hat, battle cap, that each have stolen from the other at the Regal Rumble. And we're going to see them battle it out to get it. I don't know what to expect. You know, Captain Alan has put out some promos recently where he doesn't know what a ladder is, doesn't know what a ladder's function is for. There was also another one where he didn't know that William Sterling was his brother. So I don't know how this is going to play out. Considering that Captain Alan was possibly one of the best ladder matches I've seen in person, I don't know how we're going to see that play out. Whether he's going to get knocked in the head and suddenly become Mixed Martial Alan, or Sterling Oil's Bulldog Alan Sterling again, I have no idea. But it's great to see Omar in another big marquee match that is on the show, a ladder match. Omar has been, I thought he may have been involved in the Sterling Oil stuff, but he's now pivoted a little bit, and he's trying to maybe get rid of Captain Alan Sterling. They're one win apiece from Grand City Showdown and from Regal Rumble. So this is the rubber match, and we'll see one of them hopefully concede in the end. I don't know how this is going to happen. I'm very excited for it nonetheless. The actual preview of the WrestleZone podcast, but as the match itself, buzzing, absolutely buzzing. What's next then that we can pick out here? Okay, we'll leave the Sterling Oil one for the second half. We'll have to stop soon. I'll leave that Speed title for the second half as well. Tag title match then we'll go with. So the outfit That's Murphy and Ted O'Keefe will defend against Flippy and Drippy, or as Kelly has called them all morning, Flippy and Floppy. Conor Mulhoy and Ronan King and taking going for the titles. And again, I don't know how this is going to play out. I've always got the Dino factor in mind, even though he's injured. Is he back? Is he ready? Is he going to be stepping into Ted or Murphy's place for this particular match with the Freebird rule? All that questions may be answered shortly. The match itself, it's going to be good fun anyway, because I really enjoy Flippy and Drippy. I still don't like the name Flippy and Drippy, but I like the tag team of Conor Mulhoy and Ronan King. I enjoy what the outfit are doing as well. It's very solid, it's very consistent, and that's the best way you can hope for at times. Some great spy busters, some great tandem manoeuvres in there as well. So a lot of fun things coming up in that match that I'm going to enjoy. That's it. All these matches that I'm going to see and watch, it's all matches I'm excited for. I did the preview. I ended up speaking for like an hour on this show because I was just so excited for it. All the matches had made sense. There was logic behind everything. There was story behind everything. There was not being a match just being thrown into it for no reason, which makes it all the more better. Anyway, I'm going to take a quick break while I go and drop off the dog, and we'll be back for the rest of the matches in a sec. So, see ya.
A few moments later.
Part 2. So crazy right now. So what match did I actually... I forgot. Oh, Jesus. I might end up doing two matches twice or miss one entirely. So I think I've done the ladder match, the six-man match, the tag team title match, and the VIP. So that leaves three matches we can talk about on this trip, as I cringe every time I hit the brakes. It's got MOT next week. It should be all good. Might just need WD-40. So we'll start with the Air Miles last match. So it's Alex Webb versus Stephen Air Miles, 1-on-1. Air Miles' final match, 10-year career, finishing up at Aberdeen Anarchy. This is going to be quite a emotive contest, I think. It's going to have a nice little... Well, maybe nice. It's just going to be a bit sad, really, because... oh, for fuck's sake. I'm so sorry. Yeah, it's going to be an emotional contest between Alex Webb and Air Miles. And I've seen Miles wrestle for a long time. I've seen Webb wrestle for a long time. So to see these two kind of clash, we saw a little bit of that clash at Regal Rumble, and there was good stuff in there. To compare it to anything, it's going to be like hyperbolic. It's apt how my brain's going about it, but it's like Al Shelley and Chris Sabin, you know, it's that kind of thing, because a lot of their kind of in-ring work is very machine gun heavy, inspired. So we could see them go at it one more time. Wrestle a couple of times, I think, said the preview, Reckless and other places and stuff. So I've had a couple of matches a long time ago, a few years ago. And see father and son battle out at Aberdeen Anarchy. Not much more I can really add to it. I just know that it's going to be emotional, as Vinnie Jones once said. So we're going to have a little cry during that. Speaking of having a cry then, let's talk about the six-man tag team match, which is the foundation of the future. Zach Dynamite, Bruiser Brad Evans, Ryan Riley taking on... One dickhead. Sorry, road rage there. Sterling Oil, the team of Scotty Swift. Yes, Scotty Swift and Sterling Oil. Damien William Sterling, joined by the manager, the strategist of Sterling Oil, Richard R. Russell. Hell is frozen over. Freezing would be really nice right now. 27 degrees. I've turned into Michael Cole WrestleMania here by giving you the weather updates. It's bloody hot. It's 27 degrees. But this one started, except on the whole preview, I keep saying that, but the cogs started turning at Christmas Chaos. You've got to see the attacks, and it was finally said in their last promo that the foundation of the future by attacking the foundation of WrestleZone. It was said Richard R. Russell's promo on Twitter, which was fantastic. I've always enjoyed how Richard R. Russell articulates a point. Then the foundations of WrestleZone are taking on the foundation of the future. That's the story that I've had in my head since Christmas Chaos. I can't remember if it was that episode or Granite City Showdown where I went on a big, big bit on the way home about this kind of foundation of the future versus foundation of WrestleZone thing. But I'm hyped. This is one, like, main event aside, this is the match that I'm most excited by. I've been to 10 Aberdeen Anarchies. You know, I've went to every Aberdeen Anarchy since 2013. I couldn't go to 2021, obviously. Couldn't go to 2020, obviously, because of COVID. So I've been to every Aberdeen Anarchy since the Beach Ballroom debut in 2013. So I've seen, I wasn't there right at the start of Stirling Oil, but I've seen what they've done, and I've seen some of the bigger stories that they've been put in and be part of. So I've seen that. And oh my god, someone's... Oh jeez, what the fuck? Apologies for that. Tesco van decided to emergency brake in front of me there for a second. But anyway, we're on the road, we're safe. Yeah, I've been there. You know, if I haven't been at a show itself, I have seen the clips, I have watched the stories play out about Stirling Oil and their battles with the likes of Scotty Swift, with the likes of Team WrestleZone. You know, I've seen that play out, and to see it now flip where Stirling Oil is defending WrestleZone against Foundation of the Future is fascinating. It's absolutely fascinating. I didn't, like, when I was going through the preview, I usually do about 3 to 4 minutes per match, you know, so it's just so it keeps it kind of fresh and that. I did 12 minutes of this match alone when I was speaking about it, because I am absolutely just so emotionally invested in this match. I'm emotionally invested in seeing Sterling and Damien and Scotty Swift return and Richard R. Russell return, and there's so many layers and things that I love and I've loved about WrestleZone since I started going all those years ago, 11 years ago since I went to WrestleZone, that to see that kind of all those layers come together in this 6-person match is wonderful as a fan. You know, it's wonderful to be able to see that and to see how it's developed and to remember the little intricate details that have happened on the way. And though if we took out that little detail, we'd still be just as emotional. Having those little details in there makes it all the more special. You know, it's one of those matches where it's an Aberdeen street fight, so it's going to go all over the venue. It's probably going to go out in the street at some point. It's one of those matches that I'm excited for all these matches, but this is the one that I'm going to feel the most in, I think. It's the one I'm going to have the most emotion for, because Foundation of the Future are fantastic. And as I've said to Zach Dynamite in person, during the 3 hours when that show starts and when that show ends, I hate him and I hate all of them. I think they're the most deplorable, despicable people in the world. Show ends, one of the best teams in the country, one of the best teams in the UK. You know, it's just that's how good they are in creating an emotional response. I mean, I've watched wrestling over 25 years now, and few teams maybe have that emotional response just off the bat. Just seeing them just makes my blood boil, you know. I'm not an emotional person externally, so I'm not going to be like, boo, but I'm fizzing watching them come out and be smug and be arrogant and just be bastards, you know. That's the emotional response that they gain from me every time. And then the show ends, I'm happy to call them the best team in the world. I'm happy to call them the best tag team, because they are. They've put in the body of work to earn that kind of comments and respect and all that kind of stuff. But the body of work during shows is infuriating because there's such fantastic bad guys. That's it. But yeah, so see them going against the foundation of WrestleZone. I'm hoping that we get maybe a couple surprises. I don't know. Maybe try and get a couple surprises or two of wrestlers from WrestleZone's past up here. You know, that would be quite cool. Because it's a street fight, there's no rules. Maybe we get to see some familiar faces. I would love it. I know that he's a bit of a wally at the moment, but I'd love it if Brian Tucker just jumps in for a moment. You know, just to defend WrestleZone. And because without Brian Tucker, I love that they mentioned that Brian Tucker signed off, thanks to the cajoling of East Hawkins, but some things were bigger than wrestling. You know? The explanation, I love that was put in, because we needed that. I needed that anyway. I loved that little detail. I loved the fact that I missed the promo on the ramp to Ellen. I missed watching them full. But I loved that Sterling and Damien went to Captain Allen and went to Sean Johnson as well, and they refused to be involved. I loved that was a detail that was brought in. I don't know if there was any video or anything of the approach to Mr. P. That would have been great. I love the details of them going back to the foundations of WrestleZone in order to battle the foundation of the future. It's been a fantastically crafted story. It's probably been one of my favourite stories that they've kind of put together. I would say maybe since Damien Sean Johnson, certainly since Crusher Crave Jack Jester. You know, and when it comes to a story going into a match, the pinnacle for me when it came to WrestleZone was Crusher Crave and Jack Jester. You know, I've said that for years. That was probably one of my favourite in and out stories that we got in WrestleZone. And I wrote a lot about Sean Johnson and Damien. I even wrote it for WrestleZone for some of their Aberdeen Anarchy hype stuff. So that as well. The triangle between Dynamite, Aspen and Damien was really great from a fan's point of view, but I think from a story crafted, I would say this one, the foundation of WrestleZone versus foundation of the future, it's certainly top three, maybe even top two, and right now, just right this moment, possibly number one, my favourite three-line story that's happened in WrestleZone. I mean, it's a conclusion, sucks, maybe not, but generally, the story itself has been just phenomenal. Maybe because I've added extra layers and caveats myself, maybe, but still, right the second, it's been one of my favourite storylines in wrestling, in WrestleZone, certainly. So, I think I've done our 12 minutes on that match alone. I don't think I haven't carried anything out. Even me, almost going behind a Tesco lorry. That leaves us to the main event. We've got Caleb Valhalla, the current WrestleZone Tri-Counties champion. He won the Regal Rumble 2 years in a row, and with that, he booked himself a main event place at Aberdeen Anarchy, and he'll be coming against his Skull Brawl partner, and just the tag team partner, best friend, Lost Boy Aspen. Aspen put that dispute title on the line as per the rules of the Regal Rumble, and he's going up against the Tri-Counties champion, winner takes all match. Speaking of stories, actually, Aspen put out a video last night about not giving the handshake at Regal Rumble, not staying there, sticking around at Ellen, and not turning up for my sit-down interview, which was due to be with both of them, but end up just being with Caleb. By talking about he's not sure where he stands in the matter, because he was left alone to face Flippy and Drippy at the Regal Rumble in a handicap match. Then Caleb entered himself into the Regal Rumble and won it, and it was a title match. And I love that kind of thing where he's sitting there going, he's got an absolute logical gripe, you know, whereas Caleb's got a logical point to be in that position. You know, he said it in things like he's a warrior, he's a Viking, he's a brother's fight, you know, and the thing for both of them is fighting for the best, to be the best, to fight the best, to win the riches and the biggest prizes, yeah? So Caleb's absolutely justified in his stance, but Aspen's also justified in his stance of, he's looking at it going, well, if you say you're my best friend, why are you wanting to take away the thing that means the most to me, you know? And it's just, I think, like, I talked about the six-man tag, the foundations war, being emotional, and I think it's had like almost over 10 years of story that you could throw into this somewhere, someplace, to make it even more high stakes, high pressure. But this one is going to be emotional in the sense of when Aspen came back the start of 2022. Yeah, start of 2022. He hadn't changed anything about him, but the fans loved him because he'd made good. He'd went elsewhere. He left WrestleZone and made himself a commodity. You know, he made himself a commodity. He was wrestling down south, wrestling in Glasgow. He was wrestling all about. And he said in that promo that he'd opened the doors for others to do the same. He broke down barriers to allow others to do that. And you know, when you look at it, he's not wrong. You know, I mean, we've seen some guys from WrestleZone strike out a little bit beforehand, you know, some matches here or there, but really Aspen, in my mind anyway, could be wrong, John Lyons, but he's possibly the exception, but even then he wasn't a trainee at WrestleZone. He was one of the founders of WrestleZone, you know. So it's a little bit different. But yeah, Aspen was the first guy to come through the academy and really strike out elsewhere. And he came back as the hero, because he was fighting back the foundation of the future. And yeah, he's not wrong in the fact that he broke down that barrier and he made it so guys like your Ronan King, your Conor Malloy's, your foundation of the future even, were able to get opportunities elsewhere, that people were looking at the Northeast more than just another promotion. I mean, I've spent the last 10 years talking about them being the best kept secret. I don't think that's a secret anymore. People are actually looking at the Northeast as a viable place to try and sneak in and run shows or to try and get a piece of the pie and use some of the guys from the Northeast as well. So yeah, absolutely. I don't know where I'm going with that, but just generally saying that both guys in this match are justified in their position going into this. Caleb being the warrior, wanting to face the best, be the best, Aspen's the best, his brother, brother's fight, etc. And Aspen being, why are you fighting me? We could have just went for the tag titles, it's a title shot you get. We could have went for the tag titles, we could have been Skull Brawl, all the belts, you know. So I think I'm going to be upset, but not because of like anything in particular, as in like they've ruined it. I'm going to be upset because I'm going to have to watch Aspen be merciless. Merciless, is that the word? Merciless. In this one, he's going to just ramp up that physicality that was last year into this. And Caleb, I think there's going to be a moment that Caleb's going to, I think at the end, possibly we'll see a handshake, we'll see a hug, you know, all that. But I think there'll be a moment where Aspen is wailing on Caleb, and Caleb is just going to look up and just going to see these massive blue eyes looking so sad that Aspen is battering the living bejesus out of him. And I think that's going to be a moment where your heart's going to break a bit. I've said head and heart, that's going to be my catch-all phrase for this particular match, because my heart says I want Aspen to win. Aspen's my favourite pretty much since I started watching Scottish wrestling, you know, near enough anyway. But my head goes, I want Caleb to win, I want Caleb to be the champion, because he's really captured the fandom of WrestleZone, myself definitely included. I think Caleb's fantastic, you know. So yeah, head and heart, That's it for this whole match itself. I think we're gonna sit there and see something very special. Like I said last year, it was a physical part of it. I think this year is very much the emotional part of it that we're seeing from Aspen and Caleb, which makes these shows so amazing, you know. I like kind of doing the road trips on my own a little bit because I get to do this. I get to just run the camera and I'll just talk for God knows how long. I think half an hour at this point. So we'll get into the montage very soon. But I'm very lucky to have that emotional connection to a wrestling promotion, and I think that it makes wrestling so much better that way. The in-ring's going to be fantastic. But the fact that you can layer it with a story with it, that's the best part of wrestling, in my opinion. I think I've said that a few times now in other podcasts, that you can have the great in-ring stuff, but without a story, it loses something for me. But if you can, all these matches have a story with it, and that's what keeps me coming back to WrestleZone so much, because the stories keep me going. And keep me invested and keep me wanting to see what happens next. Because when we talk right down to the pre-show, I want to see what happens if Young and Green are with Archer. I mean, I hate friendship clearly, because what if Ollie Green costs Evan Young the match? You know, what if Ollie Green has drunk Kool-Aid of Chris Archer, and he wants to be part of Archer's new, like, initiative, you know, and he drags Evan in with him? Or what if this match happens and then Evan ends up attacking Ollie after the match because Ollie's tried to interfere on his behalf and failed? There's so many things you could throw in there to make happen. And clearly, as I said, I hate friendship, so if I see a tag team or friendship, I want that split up as soon as possible. How dare you have fun, you know? But anyway, I think I've waxed lyrical enough about this show. It will have happened like weeks before this has happened. So this is all stuff that I'm saying out loud that may be right, may be wrong, but you get my raw thoughts and feelings, so enjoy them, you know. So I should be back. Next will be the montage, and then I will be driving home. Then I'll be in the studio, and then if you're still on Patreon, you should probably have it by like Wednesday, something like that, and I'll have a write-up done before then as well. Anyway, I have just passed Keith, so I'm going to go and enjoy the rest of this drive and listen to some Univision hits, because why not? So, see you later. I took some pictures, wasn't really happy with them, to be honest. I took some cool ones, but not enough to really give you the full montage experience. What a night. What a night in the annals of WrestleZone history. I have been thoroughly sports entertained from start to finish, from pre-show VIP match to the main event. It summed up everything I love about WrestleZone. Really, that's the easiest way for me to put it. It had the variety, it had the emotion, it had the big moments, it had the crowning achievements, all that kind of stuff. I had all of it, and I enjoyed it. You know, it was great, bloody great. So, since I last left you, got into Aberdeen, no bother. Decided to walk parked up. I thought, right, I'll park up, because I know this car park is an absolute bugger at the best of times. So I parked up and thought, alright, I'll go to KFC. I know where KFC is. And as I kept walking, I realised KFC was a lot further away than I thought. So I found it was a Greek King anyway, and had a little bit of food there. Hunter's Chicken, for those that are curious, want to know. So I went there, headed back, got into the queue, etc, etc. And got into the show, met Gangrel. You know, I didn't say anything stupid this time, so an improvement. It's always an improvement if I don't say anything stupid at a guest or anyone in general. So I sat down, got my seat eventually, and we'll start with the VIP. I'm going to try and remember the match order. I apologise if I don't. I'm not very good at remembering stuff. It'll be written down somewhere, though, and I'll be able to. When I do the write-up bit, I'll be all good. I'll be golden. So starting off with Edwin Young versus Chris Archer. A nice little back-and-forthy match. I think I said in my preview that I thought maybe Ollie Green might do something here. But no, he was fairly straight-laced and with the side of Edwin Young. Chris Archer eventually picked up the win. Thanks to a low blow when he went to go use the chain, Ollie Green went to try and stop him, and then in the fracas, is that the word? Chris Archer low blowed Evan Young to pick up the win. I'm looking forward to see where this goes. This is, I kind of want, as I said, I think it's in the last bit, it's kind of what I wanted. I wanted to see what Young and Green can do under the tutelage of Chris Archer, so that's their story going forward. I think we're going to maybe, I was speaking to Evan at the interval a little bit, and he was like, no, he's going to stay to himself, which, you know, that didn't concrete give me an answer whether he's going to do Archer's bidding or not, so I think that's very interesting. I like that. And we'll probably end up seeing Archer's duo against Speed Metal at some point. You know, I still think there's some unfinished business between Vago and Archer that could be used as well. So there's plenty of good stuff on the horizon with that result that I'll enjoy anyway as a fan. Onto the main show. It started off with a tag team title match. It was Outfit versus Flippy and Drippy. Not Flippy and Floppy. Flippy and Drippy. And God, these four guys, they put in a bloody shift and a half. It was great. We got to see, I like the resilience of the Outfit. They put in a lot of, they came back a lot. They were able to put a lot of their own kind of flair on things. It was just really, a really good tag team match. A really good tag team match. And we got to see a lot of big near falls from either side. We got to see the 450 splash from Ronan King, which was beautiful. I thought he may have went for the shooting star to maybe try and kind of get redemption from last year, but no, he kept it safe. Went for the 450, the lad in flush. It was fantastic. There was great little tag team moves from both teams. Just a really, really great Ron Seal, as Cultaholic likes to say. It's Ron Seal match. 7-10, it was just very good match, and the result, I'm happy with the result. I said I think I would have been happy either way, but I think after Flippy and Drippy came together and their unsuccessfulness in singles competition, I'm glad that they were able to get a title on this show. I'm glad they were able to finally win gold as a team, and I'm very happy with that result. I really enjoy Flippy Drippy. I think that was Ronan's first title as well. Connor, of course, being a former tag team champion, Crusher Grape, who will come up later on my little diatribe chat here in the darkness as I'm travelling home at 18 minutes past 10. I'm 13 degrees now for the weather watchers and curiosities there. So next up was Alex Webb versus Garrett Miles in Miles' last match. As he reminded me after the show, when I was doing a little bit of bruising around the merch stand, that I saw Miles make his debut in Dundee at the Ardler Complex, and now I've seen his final match, and that was 10 years. So I feel bloody ancient, I'll be perfectly honest with you, when I found out that fact. And the match itself, I like that Webb had started with the Fair Six Saints theme that scratched off into Chad Kroger and Josie Scott's Hero from Spider-Man, of course. I loved that little addition. I love that he came out with the YouTube plaque as well. I think we're going to see that's kind of how we're going to go forward with Alex Webb. I would have loved to see maybe a little bit of, cockiness, more cockiness, but that's stuff that could be really developed further. But the match itself, the only thing that I didn't like about the match, it has nothing to do with the match itself, is a big, tall bloke stood in front of me, sat in front of me, so I watched most of it leaning to the side. But that's nothing to do with the match itself, it's how I experienced the match. But we got a lot of back and forth. It was like a tag team wrestling each other. They know each other. They do all the stuff that they know the other does. The finish coming with the Panama Sunrise. And I think there was a number of after that, and I'm blanking, unfortunately. But yeah, we're going to see the Panama Sunrise from Alex Webb. It was a good emotional match. I think it could have been. It wasn't as emotional as possibly in the venue, but there was a little lump in my throat at the end of the match when Miles was finally pinned by Webb, because that for that exact reason I've seen Miles right from the start, and now I'm seeing him right at the end of that 10-year journey that he's had as a wrestler. I've seen him for many promotions, a few promotions. So I've seen kind of keep tabs as we go, and Fierce Saints run was I think maybe I don't think we did get the full potential of the Fierce Saints due to COVID, but I'm glad that he got tag team title gold through WrestleZone. I got to see that journey, got to see that. Remember, it's that big pop happened when they came out to fight off the Foundation of the Future, and when Aspen won the Undisputed title, I think that's possibly one of the biggest, that will always have them in a soft spot for any WrestleZone fan, that moment, and their matches with the Foundation were absolutely incredible as well, so that's always going to be remembered. But just to see where we see Alex Webb going forward, depending what happens with the Tri-County title, I would love to see Webb maybe go for the Tri-Counties and see where we can go from there. So that'd be a lot of fun. In the interim, I have missed something here. The show, the full show, I think it was. Yeah, it was the full show started with the return. We got the Clunas pop. We got Martin Clunas returned from getting battered by Bruiser Brad Evans and the rest of the Foundation of the Future Regal Rumble. So nice to see Clunas back. I love that he was wearing like a. Because the color theme for WrestleZone for Aberdeen Anarchy this year was red. I didn't end up getting a t-shirt because I didn't pre-order, and then when I arrived, all the fat lad sizes were out. I didn't get a hoodie either, because when I heard there were sizes left, all the fat lad sizes were out as well. So I had to make do. My one purchase at the show tonight was my picture with Gangrel. So that's all I'm giving away with this time. Even though there was some amazing, I really should have got the Aspen versus Caleb 2 shirt to go with last year's one, but you know, c'est la vie and all that. They probably spent a fortune just at Aspen's section of the merch stand, Aspen and Caleb's, but you know, we'll just carry on, we move, etc., and all those other kind of phrases. So yeah, Clunas back to take on the show. Where was I? So, first half main event, that's how it popped into my mind. So, Clunas was uncomfortable announcing the first half main event, which was the street fight. So, Mr. P took duties. I love that little note. I love that little piece of the story that we got. And then it moved on to the street fight itself. And I'm aware that you can't see me anymore. I will try to ramp up the brightness in the video best I possibly can. So, this match, we got. I don't think Scottie Swift got enough of a reaction, personally. You know, that's just me from this. But to see the Foundation come out with jeans and all that in street fight gear, that's something, as a detail, I forever love about when folk do that in street fight. They come out in street gear and with their knee pads over the top of their jeans and all that kind of stuff. It's just a. a lovely little note that I just appreciate in a street fight. Sterling Oil came out, Scotty came out with a Sterling Oil t-shirt on. That doesn't feel real. He's also wearing Alan Sterling's Sterling Oil gear, which didn't feel real either, as they came out. Start with a brawl, of course it did, had to, street fight. And Richard R. Russell come out as well, and wearing a Sterling Oil t-shirt as well, which, again, that felt a bit weird, because it's usually all suited and booted, you know. Big brawl, just chaos, you know, there was just bodies everywhere, slabs everywhere. Over at my corner, when I was near the merch stand, we got to see William Sterling try to ram a broom down the throat of Zach Dynamite. I was seeing bodies all over the place. I just couldn't really keep track of what was happening. When I got to the ring, other stuff happened. Some stuff didn't quite go perfectly, you know. There was a bit where Damien. Damien was on the top rope. I think the plan was, I'm sure it was, I might be wrong. Anyway, it's not important to this moment in time. The plan was for Bruiser Brad to like pop up Zach Dynamite into like a belly to belly to throw Damien over the top and into two chairs. But he missed the chairs, you know. There was stuff like that, and I think that Brad was aiming to do a rhino driver off the apron to Scotty Swift through a table that was at ringside, but there was some misfooting and ended up just doing in the games. It was like DDP's version of the Styles Clash. I can't remember, probably called Diamond Clash in the games. So I ended up doing that instead. So we got that. Before, as I'm remembering Styles Clash, that's what that got that in Webb and Miles as well, which was phenomenal, pardon the pun. Folk went absolutely mental for that. They went mad. It was great. So back to the street fight. Sterling was out fairly early on with his knee got clipped, so he was kind of at ringside while Richard R. Russell was trying to gain some sort of order or some sort of medical assistance to Sterling. As Sterling got back in later, they went to pulmonise him with the chair over the ankle, over the leg, knee, whatever, ran by that limb. And then there was a pause, and I think maybe a little bit of just the timing and technical difficulties, but there was a pause, and then we heard whom the bell tolls, and Crusher Grave came out, and it was amazing. Crusher Grave came out and just like big booted Brad, I think. And then Ryan Riley ran towards him with a chair that he slapped out into, slapped it back into the face of Riley. Came out and gave Dynamite a black hole slam. Oh, it was just amazing, you know, incredible. Before that, we had Foundation of the Future tried to bring a table into the match, and Martin Clunas ran to the ringside and grabbed it and to try and hold him off. Oh my God, this. I've said it, I put a wee note on Twitter, and it rings true 100%. This was a love letter to WrestleZone that gave back to fans, that hopefully gave maybe the wrestlers like Scotty, like Crusher, like William Sterling, and Richard R. Russell, just everyone involved, like a bit of closure, you know, to the time before the Beach Ballroom, maybe, and that kind of thing. So we got Crusher there. I loved it. I loved this match from a personal standpoint. As someone who's going to WrestleZone for coming up to 11 years, this was a love letter to the promotion. Just a letter to the fans, just to go, like, this is for you guys, you know. It was just great. So towards the end, Swift was out due to the Diamond Clash. We got Damien was out because he was handcuffed to the barrier by Dynamite. I think it was that, or he was zip tied. He was tied to the barrier anyway. During that moment when Damien got zip tied, Swift just appeared and choke slammed Dynamite on the floor. which was mad. That was cool. And after all that, Richard R. Russell got involved. Looked like Sterling demanded the cane from Russell. Russell swiped it away as he was about to bludgeon Zach Dynamite, and Russell hit William Sterling with the cane, which gave the chance for the Foundation of the Future to pick up the win. Like I say, it was just wonderful. You know, again, pardon the pun. It was just everything I wanted in that match, and maybe I wouldn't have said no, depending on where he was put in the running order, for Tucker to arrive. I wouldn't have said no for Sean Johnson to arrive, you know, but it was beautiful, you know. Was it a technical classic? No. Was it every emotional point that I wanted in that match? Yes, it was absolutely 100%. So yeah, thank you to those six, seven, eight, you know. I'll throw the refs as well. Everyone, thank you for that. That was what I wanted, and that's what I got. You know, interval time. The massive lad in front of me, like tall lad, they disappeared. So that was fine. I got the rest of the second half. We were able to just watch without having to crick my neck or stand up. You know. Second half started with the ladder match. Omar Mohamed, TV's Omar Mohamed, against Captain Allen. A bit of a different kind of ladder match. Generally for ladder matches, it's a bit mile a minute, you know, all that kind of stuff. But this had the comedy beats to it, a bit with Allen being unsure how to climb a ladder, and this sheer excitement when he was able to figure it out. I loved all that little bits. I'm interested to see where the crossover is between Omar suggesting an idea for the match and regretting the idea, because he took some hell of a bumps into ladders, like disgusting bumps into ladders. Just the clatters, the sound of him hitting it was, oh, he entered doing the old Razor Ramon struts under the ladder. Beautiful, love that. And Allen ended up walking under the ladder at one point as well, which kind of cancelled out the bad luck, I think. Cancelled it out. But yeah, Omar looked to really hurt his knee, and like I said, he did a Thundergun Express towards the ladder. Allen moved and ended up clattering both knees into the ladder. I mean, Allen took plenty of major throws into the ladders as well, so he wasn't left out of the matter. But no, it was really fun, different. It wasn't so much of like the thrills and spills, but we got plenty of them as well at the same time. So yeah, really, really fun match. Eventually Omar was able to hobble his way up and take down the Shivani and take down the captain's hat, as everyone shouted Captain Omar at him. I love the little detail. Is Omar put the jacket on, and he was getting help to the back, but he left the battle hat in the ring. So Captain Allen, though losing the match, still got his hat back at the end of the day. So I think in Captain Allen's possible mind, he didn't lose because he still got his hat back when it was all said and done in the match. So. I love the people who were buying the captain hats as well, and he was shouting at them as he entered. I love Captain Allen, I really do. I love wrestling. That's just the be all and end all to it. So semi-main, we got Fangin and Headbangin themselves, Gangrel and Speed Metal, taking on the Wallies and Judas Grey, who was very, very insistent when people were shouting at Wallies, shout Wally, that he was not part of the Wallies. He was Judas Grey. He was not part of the Wallies. So that was, I like that. I loved that. It was such a ridiculous act. Rhys Dawkins had an absolutely wonderful gear. White, it was very, very Bram Stoker's Dracula-esque, you know. had that kind of vibe to it. Brian Tucker, I'm still waiting for this Vimeo fashion blog vlog, because he matched a very silky purple waist jacket, waistcoat, Burberry tartan trousers. It was a look. Good with that. It was very much a look. And Judas was looking very snazzy. He came out in his blue and black flame jumper. I took my licks for this one. I waved at him. He came towards me. I just stood up. I took it this time. I didn't have to stop him and take my glasses off before taking it, because, you know, I think there's one little screw loose in my glasses, so I'm thinking that a Gansey getting thrown at me might be the be all and end all for them, and I wouldn't be able to get home because I wouldn't be able to drive. I wouldn't be able to see. I could drive, but I wouldn't be able to see. You know? So, this. I expected Gangrel maybe to sit on the side, or stand on the side, come in for a couple punches, maybe an impaler DDT, done, you know. But Gangrel was putting in the work. He was all over the place. He was shouting, he was getting involved, he was getting the crowd going. This man loves wrestling, you know. Gangrel loves wrestling. I don't think that is ever in doubt when you see him wrestle. Especially when I was going to the toilet before the show, and he came out, and he was like a bit hobbling. He looked sore, you know. His knees were sore. And then when the bell went, and when he came out, he was just there. It was Gangrel. It was 1998 again. Gangrel was wrestling. You know, it was so weird. And you can see Vago was absolutely buzzing for it. And you can even see, I don't think they won't admit it, but you can even see, like, Judas was excited. You can see that these guys were excited to be in the ring with Gangrel, because Gangrel wasn't phoning it in. Gangrel was involved. He was in this match. He was all up in it. And I loved that, because I love it when you can tell, when you see an import and they've come for a payday, come for just coming for the show and all that kind of stuff. But then you can see the ones that genuinely enjoy doing this, enjoy coming over, exploring, meeting the wrestlers, meeting the fans, having a match. And Gangrel was in that league. I loved it. I would love to see Gangrel Judas, like maybe a little bit of one-on-one, because we got a lot of that, but we didn't get enough of it from it. But it was, Gangrel was ace, you know. If we had to wait a few years for an import to come back to WrestleZone, Gangrel was absolutely worth it to be that guy that came back. Just, Gangrel was amazing. The match was really fun. We didn't get as much vampire-y stuff as I thought we would. But we got a lot of good fun stuff. Oh, and the Wallies successfully did their double battering ram, which they were super excited for, and I was excited for, because it's never worked so far. One of them, usually the second one, never works, but they both worked, and it was just, I loved it when they went for the high 10, they missed as well, so it was so dorky, it was just great. As far as sheer entertainment goes, this was possibly my favourite match. As sheer motion goes, it was a street fight. But sheer entertainment value, it was this six-man tag. And that led us all into the main event. And the initial thing I noticed, other than Caleb having fantastic new gear, I'm not going to lie to you, I did get a little tiny little preview of it when we did the chat with Caleb. I didn't get the full thing. They both Aspen and Caleb came out with their Discovery Wrestling tag team titles, which I loved, because it kind of cemented that their team dynamic in this one. Aspen looked to come out in his full, like the full finished product of his gear. I think I remember a chat, hopefully I'm not misremembering it, but one of our podcast chats with Aspen, he talked about how his gear evolves, and once he finishes a chapter, he goes back to black and white. and then it adds pick the flash to it as the journey goes. And it felt like when he came out, and it looked like just a complete story. And his jacket looked to be finished. It had the sort of pink fur on it. His gear had a lot of pink, a lot of black, like paint splatter on it. It looked to be finished, you know. So when he came out with that, I was like, I think this is it, you know. I was always on the fence. Again, head and heart, as I've always said, head and heart. But when Aspen came out in that gear, I thought, that looks like that's the end of the chapter gear. It did not take away from my enjoyment of the match in the slightest, you know. I was still standing the whole time. I didn't have a heart rate monitor because it probably would have broke it, you know. And this was a different match. As I said, last time it was a physical match. These guys were fighting over the title. And I felt this time there was more emotion, which is what I was expecting and wanting from it. There was a bit more hesitation is not the word, but there was a bit more, hesitation may be the word, but I felt like Aspen was conflicted whether to go 100% into the physicality of things or whether to wrestle, just make it a sportsmanlike contest, you know. I felt that was in there. And in the last bit I talked about, I was waiting for a moment that possibly would happen where Caleb would be looking up with his blue eyes and waiting for Aspen to do a bad thing, whether it was just the death shot or what. And we got that because Aspen eventually grabbed the disputed title, and as Caleb was getting up and looked up, and it was the conflict. Aspen threw down the title to make it more of a sporting contest. The referees got knocked down. I will say though, that might be the most convoluted one for Dennis. I'm not going to lie. It was a kick out, and Aspen had the pin. Caleb kicked out, and Aspen kind of lurched back and landed on Dennis. I'm going to call shenanigans on that one. I'd always been a long night though, so that could have been the reason. A bit of fatigue with a little bit of a bump, you know. And the second referee came out, it was the little lad from, I'm sure I've seen a ref before, but I can't remember where. I think it might have been, it can't have been Chaos, because that was all the green. It might have been a Pierhead. I can't remember. I'm sure I've seen the little lad before. He was a small boy. He got killed with a spear, and Mikey Innes was in charge for the rest of the match. I was thinking at that point, if Mikey Innes got taken out, would I have to ref at some point? You know, we'll just work our way through. Kev gets his mention because he got kicked by Aspen. Of course, there's not a show that goes by where Kev's on the ring crew and doesn't get battered by somebody, you know. It's just tradition now. He's not going to like that tradition, but it's tradition now. That's it. It's in the books. This has so many close calls during the two refs going down. We had Aspen hit the hell ride we had Caleb hit the hell ride onto Aspen, and that was like a 10 count. The referee was out, and then we got a double underhook pile driver to Caleb from Aspen, but again the count couldn't be made because the referee was down. So we've got that kind of, they were both equal in that respect as well, back and forth, etc. Some heavy shots, but like I say, it wasn't as physical as last year because it played more on the being a team and being brothers and all that kind of stuff. It was just beautiful, you know, fantastic. Eventually ended with a second rope hill ride from Caleb to Aspen, which possibly wasn't the cleanest, but it was still a spectacle enough for it to do the job, and we got the finale, the end of the match from that. I loved it. I stood the whole match. I bit my nails. I just couldn't take my eyes off it as well. It was just great, fantastic, just wonderful. And after the match, Aspen grabbed the Undisputed title, eventually handed it to Caleb. Caleb offered his hand, it was slapped away, and we hugged it out. We got a hug between Aspen and Caleb. Skull Brawl still alive and well in WrestleZone, which I'm glad about. And well, I had an absolute ball. I love wrestling. You know, I just love it. I didn't really hang about afterwards. I was going to try to get a pick with Caleb with the titles, but he'd went backstage and seen Nell was there, and I thought, you know what, with silly bollocks with myself just hanging about, I'm just going to get home and make sure I get enough sleep and that so I can see Jack in the morning. You know, that's kind of my life now, and I'm very happy with it. Yeah, it was just great. It was just great. Wrestling at its core is stories, and WrestleZone always do it for me. They hit the right spots for me emotionally, and they've done it again for Aberdeen Anarchy. I plan to go to Battle of the Nations this year. I plan to do all that kind of stuff. I think, again, the only one I'm missing at their main show is going to be Hijinks, because I'm going to say, if we see Les Miserables, we see that in PJ. That's a bucket list one for me, so I have to go that. Yeah, I love wrestling. I'm drunk on wrestling, and it's wonderful. I don't know how much more I can say other than fantastic. This was great. It was a great night. I was able to speak to Air Miles. I was able to speak to, I spoke to Judas briefly. Apparently he has been told, he's been getting suggestions of things to throw at me, and he's kind of said that what he has thrown at me, to be honest, is light in comparison to what has been suggested to him. So that hurts my feelings, folks. So thank you for that. doesn't really. That was a lot of fun. I love the Gangrel came out after the show as well. He had his wee speech, a little bit of rah-rah speech, but it was great. Thank you everyone, thank the fans. This guy loves wrestling. Gangrel loves wrestling. And we should all have an example set by Gangrel, and that is, he is amazing. This is a great show, great guest. All the matches delivered, all the matches give us more to the future going forward. I hope some new fans were made tonight. I hope some fans were retained. I hope just that every show sells out. It looked like, again, it was a walk-up sellout. So I think there was like 60 tickets at the start of the day. I didn't see an empty seat. I mean, folk left during, lads. Some of them like moved about and left after the half-time or want to see Gangrel and leave. That's fairly typical when there was an important time. But generally, at the start of the show, I don't think there was an empty seat available for it. So I would say it was definitely a sellout. Great big venue. I think they could probably even push the barrier that they had back a little further, possibly, if they're going to do that. But I think if we're looking for a new venue for Aberdeen Anarchy to replace the ballroom, the Rich Energy Arena is a pretty good shout to have. I didn't realise how close it was to the beach, but to be honest, when I first, my first ever beach ballroom show, I didn't realise how close the beach ballroom was to like Cadonas and Cadonas is a chippy in help. Cadonas and how close it was to the centre. So my sense of direction is absolutely shocking, as I've already proven by thinking the KFC was closer to me than it was. I just enjoy wrestling, and WrestleZone just do it for me every time. They always deliver. They've made an impact on me in 11 years. They keep doing it. They keep doing these things. They keep leaving me an emotional mess after shows. I'm going to try and remember some of this to write it down as well. We'll record the recap as well. But yeah, it was beautiful. That's the word I'm going to use now. It's beautiful. Wrestling is great. I have just passed Huntley, so I'm going to go and listen to the results of Eurovision as it happens, and maybe see the end of it as well. Enjoy wrestling, guys. This next bit will probably be briefly in the studio going, I have nothing more to add, but maybe I will. Who knows? Let's find out. Together. 3, 2, 1.
2 days later.
Back in the studio. I'm still figuring out where to put this microphone so it doesn't look like because of this new camera setup. It zooms out. I need to zoom in. I don't need to work out technology, so we'll try as we go. Anyway, that was a show. This is Monday as I'm recording this bonus little bit at the end because I've recorded like almost an hour just from the journey and the journey home. I haven't really, and that's without the montage being involved. So I think I'll just add a couple more extra thoughts here before I fire up that laptop behind me and start editing away. But yeah, it was just a couple of days to reflect on it and seeing the comments and the stuff on the interweb about it, and it was just a fantastic night. I think Kirsten Louise of Kirsten Louise Photography noted that one of the matches, Alex Webb, Air Miles, was possibly underrated, like underappreciated, and I think she's right in that respect. I think out of all the matches that had these big explosive moments, you know, that match was fantastic. It was maybe underappreciated in the grander scheme of things, but it was great. It was great to see Air Miles afterwards, and like I said in the last bit, I'm looking forward to see what happens with Alex Webb. Hopefully we still see him regularly up in the Northeast. But no, it was just a great night of wrestling and a great experience. And as I've said a few times now, the whole thing, especially the street fight, was properly a love letter to WrestleZone, and just gave everyone who had been watching, whether it was for a couple of months, a year, 10 years, a moment to take in and love and enjoy and just enjoy wrestling for, you know. It was a great night. I don't want to labor on much more because you know, it's been an hour already and you haven't even had the musical interlude break. You've just had me speaking in a car for ages. But yeah, it was just fantastic. I love Aberdeen Anarchy Nights. They always just nail it. They always deliver the stories, deliver the wrestling, and deliver the moments. And that's what they want from wrestling, to be honest, at the end of the day. As long as I feel something, some emotion, then I'm going to enjoy it. I'm very easily pleased when it comes to wrestling. But to see likes of the other six man, one Gangrel in it, see the wrestlers involved, like they looked hyped and buzzing to be involved. Even Judas Grey, the sullen Judas Grey, you could tell when he was getting winged about with clotheslines or what have you by Gangrel, that you could see there was a glint in his eye that he was loving life and loving it in general. That's opposed to the picture that will be as part of the montage of him looking really solid, the usual. So yeah, it was a fantastic night. I can't really add any more about it. I'm gonna do a write up about it as I kind of regain my bearings and look through the photos by Kirsten, by Brian Batsby, and go through all those couple of pictures that I got. I didn't get that many good ones, so I made a montage about it. I didn't get any videos either, so I was very much enthralled by the wrestling and just wanted to enjoy the wrestling for the evening. So yeah, there seems to be, I think we came out of Aberdeen Anarchy with no major injuries. Like Omar Mohammed is just in pain, constant pain, but he still was able to wrestle for Mega Slam, so because Omar Mohammed is an absolute warrior. So I think we escaped this year without any, and nobody got stabbed in the eye, nobody broke anything, I don't think. So I think we got out of Aberdeen Anarchy unscathed, and now we get to see what happens in the run up to Battle of the Nations. We've got two new champions. We've got not an undisputed champion, because it sounds like the Tri-County's undisputed title will still be separated. But we've got Kayla Valhalla. Right, Kelly was not very smug. She had that face of, you know, like, I think it's worse that she didn't say I told you so than her like going, you know. I think it might feel worse. So yeah, she's very happy with Caleb becoming the Undisputed WrestleZone champion. I'm happy as well. I was tense the whole match because I thought when Aspen came out in his complete gear, I was like, oh god, he's either losing the title or he's going to become the biggest bastard in the world. And I was like, I don't know if I can take either. But yeah, it was delight. It was great. I like feeling at wrestling. I like to feel feelings. Stop at wrestling. You're making me feel feelings. I'm a robot. I'm a non-emotive, unreactive robot. Stop making me enjoy wrestling and make me bite my nails stand up the back and just not be able to sit down because I need to see everything Anyway, so this has been the latest road trip. The next one, we wait. I think the next one's gonna be Community Pro. So it's a good wee while away, a couple months now at this point. So we'll keep you up to date with other goings on. I might do a preview thing for Clash of the Castle because I wasn't gonna go anyway. I certainly wasn't gonna pay the ticket prices that they've got, but I wasn't planning to be down in Glasgow anyway. So I might do a wee preview, might do something on the day, might do a live tweet thing, I don't know. I haven't really planned that. That's a month away as of doing this. So that's plenty of time for me to think about that. But no, in the meantime, thank you for everyone that came up to me that complimented me on the podcast. I was very much appreciative of seeing David, seeing Jonathan, seeing everyone that was there who said hello, liked what we do here with the WrestleZone podcast, All About the Disco, the SW podcast, this and the mainline SWN podcast is very much appreciated. It keeps me doing it, even though our YouTube algorithm has gone to absolute shit. But I appreciate, anyway, thank you for listening. That seems to be what most of you are doing, is listening. It's great. And I'm not subjected you to a 3-minute montage of music this time. It's just going to be the view of the ring, and then you will know by now, but it'll be a view of the ring, and then it'll be the couple pictures I got with Gangrel, Judas Grey, and Evan Young, who hadn't had a picture with Evan before, so I'm glad I got to take that one off into the old Facebook album of pictures. But yeah, I'll keep wrapping up and then go into another point. So I'm definitely going this time. A fantastic night at WrestleZone. I can't wait until Battle of the Nations. I think I'm probably going. There's some things going on around about then that may mean I have to wait until Inverurie in September, which is a very long wait to see wrestling again. But we'll see what happens and see what happens there. But in the meantime, yeah, fabulous night from WrestleZone. Thank you for watching SWN podcast. Thank you for watching us go. Me go a little bit mad in the car on the way home and just get excited about wrestling, because if I don't get excited, what's the point, you know? Let's go. Follow us, swnscotland.com, and go to our website. You find all the links there. Twitter is at ScottResNet. Same with Instagram, same with Facebook, I think, as well. Follow us on Spotify. Check us out on YouTube. Specifically, that would be fantastic. I think it's youtube.com/ScottishWrestlingNetwork. I think I kept that one quite subtle. And all the other stuff, 10% off at renderbomb.com if you wish to off your first order, use the code SWN10. Manscaped.com, you're able to get 20% off with the code SWN20. We're doing some cool stuff here at the Scottish Wrestling Network. I've just got to try and keep that momentum going and have a good day. So yeah, we're wrapping up now, definitely this time. Goodbye, good night, good evening. Good morning. I'm gonna go have a sleep. Have a good one. Enjoy rest.